think about possibility to talk here. I think you can hear me. If you don't, please tell me and I will speak loud. So, let's start. Start with some example. So it takes some area, let's say Mexico City area, and you measure the number of earthquakes during the one year, for example. For example, you measure like you have 1,000 of magnitude 4, 100 of magnitude 5, and so forth. And that's a general pattern. So in each area with earthquakes, you will see the similar pattern. And you see the same with all the other possible things, like for water level of Nile, for velocity of a car, and so on. And we can draw a graph of that. For example, like you can see the speed of cars on a left highway, and you measure how much time you have a speed 5, okay, which 5 was it? 3, 9, 27, 81 kilometer per hour. And so and it happens, that let's say for you have a speed 81 kilometer per hour just for 1 minute. Then you have such a speed 27, like say for 5 minutes. And you have the speed 8, 9 for 25 minutes. And sure, most of the time you have speed 3 kilometers per hour in the traffic. And it's kind of 125. And so you see such a beautiful line. And it happens for all these possible measurements. For example, for cities with population bigger than something. You see always the same picture. And so, what is that? Sometimes that's called 1 over F noise. And that means that the energy of an event is reciprocal to the frequency of the event. Let's say, so what is the energy of an earthquake? So normally it's just by definition, there's some exponent of its magnitude. In fact, there's a definition of magnitude. And you see that in our example, the energy of earthquakes is reciprocal, like 1 over F to the frequency. That's called 1 over F noise in physics. And also, you can draw it on the logarithm scale, like here. So in our example, for earthquakes, you have energy times frequency is a constant. And if you draw it on logarithm scale, you have logarithm equals some constant minus logarithm, just the usual line like that. In that direction, so if you have such a line in logarithm scale, then you have such a equality for your quantities. That's called power law. And it was a big mystery for physicists why so many things in the real life obeyed such a power law. So it was a kind of question. And for example, if you measure the number of earthquakes with given energy, then the constant air is about like once in something. And if you measure, this is for number of fjords in Norway with given length, it's also kind of similar. It's also kind of similar law, but with constant like 1.6. So it's universal laws, but nobody knows why they exist. Okay, now some explanation. So if you consider some system in balance, in the balance, it means what I wrote here. Like if you change something just a bit, system doesn't change much. And in such system, you don't see these beautiful events like catastrophes, like one of noise, or fractals, like fjords. They're kind of fractals. But most of the time, okay, yeah, in here. So if you want to have some special events, you need to tune parameters. Like if you want that water became a gas, you need to have temperature 100 degrees Celsius. So it's not by itself. So you need to do something, and then you have a catastrophe or something. And previously, like 15 years ago, everybody was studying only, balanced systems, like in economics, biology, etc. For example, even now in economics, the most popular model is kind of equilibrium. You have prices, you have some wishes of people to buy something, and it's kind of equilibrium. It doesn't change over time. And that was the same for biology. Like, it was supposed by that biology, that evolution changed not rapidly, like with constant speed, without any leaps. But in fact, it's not true. Let's say in economics, a small thing can produce a very big effect. The same in economics. You can prove that you have very stable configuration of species, then nothing happens, then at a very short period of time, a lot of new species appear. That's kind of our life. And the very canonical example of all these events is a sand pile. So you have a sand, and then you start to drop it. From the beginning, the sand falls like that. And like that, like that, like that, like that. And then at some point, when you drop additional sand here, it gives you a very big avalanche. So sand falls. And this avalanche of the size of the whole system. So kind of the size of the whole heap of the sand. And they thought, some physicians, that could be a model for all these events. That we can study some universal behavior of sand and understand something new about all the other examples, like in traffic, and in biology, and evolution, and so on. And so they wrote a paper at some moment, which is called self-organized criticality, and I think that's the most cited paper in physics, at least for that time. I don't know for now, but if you type it on Google, you see about 7,000 citations. It's quite a lot. So it became extremely popular after that, after they discovered the model I will propose to you. And the idea is the following. So we have so many models where we have such power laws that we cannot expect that this can be explained by the some properties of these models. So it's kind of universal law. It means that if you want to study all these models, we can choose any of them, any simple mathematical model, and study only it. And that will be enough. Because all the models are so totally different that it doesn't matter which one you study. And they consider some model with pendulum. I will explain what that. So first of all, they understood that in your model, you should have a lot of small things. And these small things should interact somehow. And this interaction will produce a kind of big behavior, like for some grains here. And sometimes we will see a big change in the system. So what is the model with pendulum? So I'll describe the one-dimensional model. It's like that. You have a line. It is a kind of a ribbon. And here, at every point, you have a pendulum. The pedal can rotate like that. So you have a lot of them. And then what happens if you rotate one of them, let's say here, like you force it to rotate one time. Then it gives some tension to the neighbors. And somehow they're also forced to rotate, probably. And if you rotate it two times, then each of the neighbors will rotate one time, because this is a ribbon. And you can consider the same like in two-dimensional case. Again, you have a grid. And at every vertex, you have such a pendulum. And they propagate some tension across the lines here. And it happened that this model produce exactly the same behavior as expected. So sometimes you rotate the pendulum by random, and then you see how many of them, of others, also rotate. And it happens that this number of others, the size of avalanche, also obeys power law. And then they started to think about that. Another example. So I can see the following sand model. So you imagine you have a number of squares like that. And then, if at some point this tip is about 2, sand falls here. And you can prove some equivalence that this situation, this pendulum, is equivalent to the following. When here you rotate a pendulum, you just add additional sand grain here. And sometimes it just falls. And kind of this tip here increases, and this tip here increases. Like when, if you move this part here, steep here, will increase. And so this is equivalent to the pendulum model. And also you can consider the model for square grid the same. And then finally they come up with a very simple definition of the model you should consider. I will give you this simple definition in a minute. Yeah, okay, so this size of avalanche obeys this law for earthquakes. And here we didn't have any parameters to tune, so this behavior appears just by itself. And now that's the model. It's extremely simple. SandPile is a collection of chips or sand grains on a subset of Z2. And then, if at some point you have four of them, you can redistribute sand grains to the neighbors. So it's like that. So here you had 1, 3, 3, 3, 0 sand grains. Here you had four. Then you can redistribute it, one to each neighbor. And you see, these are also became four. So they are also unstable now, and you can topple them. And if you start with a big graph, some distribution, it can be a very long process, because some became stable, some became unstable, and so on. And this process is called the relaxation. And if you start with a big grid on the plane, you start to drop grains randomly, then at some point you will see that the size of avalanche start obeying this power law. That's kind of miracle. And these physicists, they claim that, okay, it's enough to study only that model. It's equivalent to all the other models for earthquakes and for other stuff. Okay, so what is our random process in details? We fix any finite subset or any graph with streets. And we drop sand. And if sand falls outside of our graph, it disappears. So you can formalize it in two ways. Like either you said that the sand which falls outside disappears, or either you say that, okay, you have such a graph, and then you claim that all the vertices here can identify it in one vertex, which is called sink. And if sand falls into a sink, it disappears. And all of them are glued together. So it's the same for any graph. And then you can ask some questions like, what is the probability of a given state to appear? And they start some simulation because it's really easy to write down for a code, to run a program, to see the results. And they found that there's a special collection of states, this distribution of sands, which appear with equal probability. So you start dropping sand, then at the beginning some strange things happen, but then after some time, you have only these configurations, and all of them repeated with the same probability. How can one prove that? Okay, like that. So we want to introduce some structure on all the states. What is the most natural structure? It's addition. So we have two distributions of sand. We can just add them and then relax. And this gives you addition. And that happens that the set of the states which appear with non-zero probability, they constitute a group, which is called sand pile group. And even more mysterious, that the size of this group, the amount of elements, is the number of spanning trees of our graph. So one can prove it, it's not very hard, but it gives you a lot of connection with combinatorics. So when you want to compute some things like number of trees, number of cycles, some tat polynomial, so on, it is connected with sand pile group. And then you can prove that each stable state is equivalent to some element of this group. So you have such a map from all the states to the group. And then when you add some grain at the vertex, so what does it mean? It means that you add a configuration which is zero everywhere and one here. This configuration corresponds to some element in this group. So just some random dynamic on our group. We have some preferred choice of elements, and then we can add them randomly. And after that, it's easy to prove that all the elements appear with the same probability. Okay? Okay. So now I ask you, so what is the identity element in that group? Any ideas? Ernesto?
Well, I know how it looks for several.
Ah, okay. So the first idea is just the identity element is zero everywhere.
It's very complicated picture.
Yeah, because when you add zero state to our state, it doesn't change. But zero state, this state with zero grains everywhere, it's not stable. It is stable, but it's not recurrent. So you cannot obtain it with probability bigger than zero. Because if you start with it, it never came back. Because we always have some grains somewhere.
So this is this E square equals E thing that they do.
So, but there is procedure to calculate this identity. It looks like that. So it's very complicated. And nobody knows how to kind of, you know, prove anything about identity. You can just calculate it. So you start with such a big square grid, then you work hard, you calculate all this group. It's quite a big group. As I said, the number of all spanning trees here. By some more simple algorithm, you can calculate the identity. It's like that. And nobody knows why it's so symmetric. So, okay. Now, second topic, it's when we have some convergence of all the sample belts. So again, you start with another state. So we start with a state which is zero everywhere except one point. So it's everywhere zero, one point is very big number n. You relax it, and very big some pile here. When you relax it, it's kind of very big an area. In fact, square root of n. And you ask the question, so what is the dependence on n? Is there some limit or something, is it similar or not? And it happens that, yes, also kind of fractal structure. But for n big enough, you always see picture like that. And when you rescale your picture by square root of n, you have a well-defined limit. So it's drawn here. It's also a miracle. So, but it is proven that there is a limit. It is even discovered some patches here. One knows the coloring of each patch. But I think it's not kind of at least published so that the limit is exactly like that. So it's only computations. Another topic is about tropical curves and sand piles. I think yesterday we had some lecture about tropical curves. So probably you know what's that. And here I start with the maximum stable state. So in previous slide I start with zero everywhere, and here I start with three everywhere. So each vertex I have maximum stable number of sand grains. And then I fix some omega, that's my omega, inside a red line. And I choose some points inside this omega. And then I consider a grid. And this grid, 1 over n of z square, just usual z square grid, but with mesh 1 over n. And when n grows, it kind of becomes smaller and smaller. And I have a graph. I take only the vertices inside my omega. And I consider the following state. I take 3 everywhere, but then I add additional sand grains at points close to my chosen points. So for each grid, that will be different points. Okay, I choose some of them, who closest to one of them. And then I relax the state, and I look at the result where the final state is not 3. Experimentally, you can see that the final state after the relaxation is almost everywhere 3. So it's kind of natural to consider this set, where it's not 3. And here are the pictures. So blue points are the points where I drop additional sand grains. White means 3, and other colors means less than 3. And so at the very beginning, I see some kind of waves of sand going back and forth and so on. And at the end, I have a useful curve. So probably you know that's a tropical curve. I will not give any definitions about that. Okay. Any questions? Okay. So also you can study the same problem on other omegas. So not integer polytops. For example, a circle. And then you see that when the mesh of your grid tends to zero, like you see, here the grid is 3 times smaller. You have a well-defined limits. So, but it seems so on the picture. And here's the limit in this case. So just a very special orbital curve inside the circle. And here is there's the limit of Toppin function. Toppin function is the following. So at every point, you count how many toppings you have here. And it happens that the Toppin function is kind of piecewise linear. For example. And convex, yeah. Okay, and also this zero on the boundary. Because on the boundary we cannot make toppings. It's prohibited. And here it's some explanation. So let's consider this number of toppings at a given point. And that's a proposition that if the number of some grains didn't change during the relaxation, then you have such an identity. So can you prove it? Should be easy for you. So you can.
Well, you just consider the neighboring points.
Yes.
And the things that come from there have to be the same as the things that come from the center point.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So you can just count the number of incoming and outgoing grains. So left part here is some incoming, because each neighbor gives one single grain. Here is number of outgoing. Okay? And so you kind of see that if you start with square with three everywhere, and if you end with three everywhere, it means that at most points the state didn't change. It means that our function is almost ever harmonic. And then it's easier, because you look at the Toppin function here, it's piecewise linear. Piecewise linear function is harmonic on its linear parts. So the only place where our function is not harmonic, that's the only place where the, we can see the set where it's not three, it's across the non-smooth points of our function. And that's exactly our orbital curve. So that's kind of easy explanation for the pictures. Okay. And now some open problem about that. So previously, you see that if you drop some number of some grains here, then the number of points with less than three is kind of linear. So for one point, it's just one graph. Then you drop another point, it's again a graph. So the number of colored points grows linearly by the number of points. So you expect that if you drop, so I wrote it here, so if you drop epsilon times n square some grains, then you should have about epsilon times n cube colored points. So kind of all the square will be colored. But it's not true. So in reality, if you drop such amount of colored points, then you indeed you have some bad behavior near the boundary here. But in the center, you always have tropical curve, which is kind of very simple. So it always occupies kind of epsilon part of the area of the square. For example, here, just the scale is bigger, that's why we see a small curve. But then if you rescale such that it becomes an unusual scale, you see the same picture. So it gives you some notion, I don't know, like a random tropical curve or something. But we don't know why it's true. So that's the question, and we don't know how to answer that. And okay. That's the references. I highly recommend you to read this book, How Measure Works. That's about all these power laws, with a lot of examples, with a lot of some physical motivation. They explain this pendulum example in very details, about all the stable systems and all the other. Also, two is some introduction paper to send files, just 4-page long. It's very good. Then, the pictures I mentioned to you, they are found in this paper of Paoletti and others. So there's also some physicists who run a lot of experiments, found beautiful patterns, but for physicists it's normally kind of not interesting to prove something. They just found the pictures, said, okay, pictures are always like that, so we are happy. Then you see it's quite recent, all of that. And then In this paper, it was proven that example that we drop a lot of points at zero, that there is a kind of conversion, there is a limit of rescaling pictures. Here, they had some ideas about the patches in this limit. And here's our article about this, where we proved that this is kind of convergence for turbulent curves for this first part of the problem. Which are not kind of close, it's obvious. Because it affects only this part, it affects only this part. And so for points which are close, so let's just do the computation. So you have 4 and 4 here. So if you relax this point first, you have here 0, here plus 1, plus 1, plus 1, plus 1. Then you relax here. You have here plus one.
Suppose it was 4 and 3.
Oh, okay. Imagine that you have a sequence of toppings. Uh-huh. I prove that I can exchange any two of them. That's enough.
Okay. Alright. If you start with 4 and 3, and then 3 becomes 4 after the topping.
Yes.
Then you can't exchange because you cannot top on 3.
Yeah, but that doesn't matter because if you had 4 and 3, then you had no option. You had to double 4.
Okay.
I mean, it's just exchange only all the kind of possible topics.
Okay. So we already have 2, which have 4 or more.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
And then just complete the top.
Yes.
Okay. And the convergence also. I mean, why
relaxation? Yes.
Yeah.
Because you start this finite number of some grains, you have a sink somewhere. And if you have a number of time of toppings here, then you have infinite number of times of topping in neighboring, means that you have an infinite number of times of topping here. It means that infinite number of some grains leave your system. That's not possible. But you know, we can even have relaxation for infinite graphs. But it's kind of more tricky. No, infinite number of grains.
Ah.
For example, you start with omega, which is, let's say, like that. So infinite, like an interior of parabola. And we start with 3 everywhere, and we add some points somewhere, and then the relaxation always exists.
But not for all omega, just for some.
I think it's enough to have only one thing. Yeah, if you start with kind of 3 grains everywhere, mm-hmm. then you add finite number of grains, if there is a sink, that's enough. But if you start like with 4 grains everywhere, it will not end. That's true.
More questions?
Yes. I have heard about samples in other graphs. And I understand that when you consider the grid C2, it's the only way when you relate the tropical geometry with this.
No, it's not the only way. But that's the way I like.
For example, so you if you consider other graphs, you can relate these.
Yeah, I can tell you 5 things about that. No problem. This send file game was discovered many times. So I told you only about the discovery by physicists who tried to model this power law behavior. But what is covered earlier, like just any games on graph. And it was discovered early in algebraic geometry too. So imagine that you have a family of curves. So that's a disk. Then when t goes to 0, sometimes you have degenerations. And your algebraic curve degenerates to some components. Draw like that. And then you can draw a graph of these components. Like in this example, it would be like that. So for each component, you have vertex. If two components intersect, you have edge between them. And then you can study the following question. So you had dividers on each of such curves. So divider is just collection of points on algebraic curve. Then when you degenerate that, you will have a divisor on the components. And you can assign to that a divisor on the graph. If you have here 1, 1, 2, 1, and you have here 1, 1, 2, 1, and 0 other vertices. And then it happens that the theory of divisors on curves is kind of parallel to the theory of divisors on such graphs. And the move in algebraic geometry, when you want to go to a Hilbert divisor, you multiply by a rational function. And here, you do exactly this movement with sand. So you redistribute, for example, you can take this 2 and write here plus 1 and here plus 1. So exactly this moves with grains.
In the other direction.
Yeah, in the other direction too. Yeah, because, and then you can study the sand pile group. Because sand pile group is exactly this set of all non-equivalent configurations of sheaves here. And then you have a really parallel theory. Let's say this Riemann-Roch theorem for dividers here, and there is a Riemann-Roch theorem for dividers here. And that's why it's very interesting for algebraic geometers to study dividers on graphs and this. But then they call this chip firing, because they consider it like chips, and then you can fire a chip, a collection of chips in different in neighbors. And
¿Más preguntas en español?